Hello and welcome to the Championship Talk podcast. I'm your host, Paul O'Toole, and joined somewhere, I always point in the wrong direction, is my co-host, Thomas Falco.
Hello!
So before we get into the pod, and we have got, obviously we had the FA Cup break, so we've got a couple of rounds of fixtures to go through. We just want to say that it's tough right now, and it's okay to not be okay. And we want to point out some of the mental health awareness charities that are about. You've got Mind, you've got Calm, you've got the Samaritans. Don't suffer in silence. We're going to be talking about on the podcast about football. And for most people, that's your outlet. Obviously, very different to how it was a year ago, pre-COVID, with all the lockdown that's going on, financial worries, etc. Do reach out, because, you know, you're never alone, and it's kind of, we just want to put that out there before we start talking about football and all the stuff that's going on, because I think that kind of that's important to us, isn't it, Thomas?
It is, yes, and at the end of the day we do this to hopefully entertain, but at the end of the day football doesn't really matter as such. It's you as an individual and the loved ones around you that matter. So yes, there is always someone out there to talk to help you in these times, so please never feel like you're alone.
Perfect. So we're going to move on to the news, and there is quite a bit that's happened, and one club kind of dominates the news segment, but we'll start at the top. Neil Harris has parted ways with Cardiff.
Yes, this was announced today, wasn't it? We were talking about our notes last night and said, oh, we've got enough news to talk about, and I think you said, oh wait, someone will get sacked tomorrow. And yes, after the result in the midweek fixtures, yes, it was Neil Harris, unfortunately. 6 consecutive league games with defeats. I think that was, five consecutive league defeats and 1 in the FA Cup. So 6 in total. He has parted company with Cardiff today, along with the assistant manager, David Livermore. Just looking at his statistics in total, since he was appointed to replace Neil Warnock when he left Millwall. He actually left Millwall and then later on went to Cardiff, didn't he? Played 62, won 24, drew 18, lost 20, a 37.8% win percentage. I was looking in the total overall scheme of things of Cardiff managers in history. He's about mid-table as far as the success rate goes. They are currently 15th in the table, 13 points adrift at the playoff places and 9 points above the relegation zone. And the announcement from Vincent Tan and the club said that there would be a permanent manager and assistant announced in due course. And also Vincent Tan said, I'd like to thank Neil and David sincerely for their hard work at Cardiff City. Their efforts to propel us towards a 5th place finish and a playoff position last year were recognised and appreciated. Although sadly we are in a results orientated business and our on-field results of late and progress this season has been very poor. As such, we had no choice but to relieve them of their duties in an effort to improve results and league position with a change of manager. Little bit of a difference there between Mr. Tan and Mr. Chancery when it comes to parting company with managers.
Well, I think they gave Neil Harris ample time. It was always a strange, I always thought it was a strange appointment for Cardiff. I think the reason I think that is because I think Neil Harris, with the right club and the right, he probably is better with a team that has less resource, and he can make the most of what he's got with, perhaps, you know, he's making his way in the football manager sort of circle, and I think he probably wants to achieve something with a smaller club. Cardiff, their aspiration is Premier League. It's as simple as that. That's the goal for them. Whether they've quite got the squad to do it, I don't think so, but I think that's what their goal ultimately is.
Yeah, I mean, their budget may be a little bit bigger, obviously with financial fair play, they've got money from when they come down from the Premier League, haven't they? Not to say that they're absolutely loaded, but they may have more than some clubs. Neil Harris, I think, earned his right to manage a club like Cardiff, who are an upper echelon Championship club in recent history, aren't they? When you look at their time in the Premier League, they've been in the Premier League a couple of times, haven't they? And their positions in the Championship as well. He deserved that opportunity. He's not disgraced himself. You think he'd done a good job in taking Cardiff up into the playoffs last season? A late surge got them there. That can't
epic
be forgotten.
Last day of the season.
Yeah, well, epic for some. It was, but no, he did do a half decent job. Obviously, as Vincent Tan has quite rightly said, this is a results business, even more so than ever as each year passes. I think you can't overlook a run as bad as that and not have to make some sort of decision. I'm sure Neil Harris, as you said, will bounce back at the right level with a championship club. He's still very young. He's 43 years old. I mean, he'd done a marvellous job at Millwall. I mean, you can't overlook what he'd done with that club in getting them to the brink of the playoffs even, wasn't he?
The resources he had are far, far less at Millwall. I think maybe I undersold him a little bit. I think you're probably right. He probably did deserve the opportunity. I just don't think it was the right. I don't think the club had the right profile. I think. Look at what Neil Warnock's doing at Middlesbrough, and I think Neil Harris could probably do a similar job with the profile of club. I think Cardiff. I think they're going to want to play good football. They're going to want to play exciting football, and they're probably going to want to. You know, they're going to want the results to come at the end of it. So that's going to be interesting to see who they appoint next, because I think it's going to be a different world with Brexit and managers coming in. We're probably going to see some lower league managers getting more opportunities. So watch that space. We are going to cover that in a little bit more detail as the detail of work permits, etc. Starts to be affected by Brexit, because I think that'll have an impact on managers.
I was going to say, just before you move on, because I had a look at the betting odds this afternoon when I heard the news, and the favourite, the market, it was quite clear that there was no idea who was going to be manager. It was like 6-1 the field.
Everyone's
for the favourites. I'm just looking at the odds as of 8:15 this evening. Mick McCarthy is currently the favourite now. It's 7-4, so it's obviously been a little bit of money for him. Mark Bowen.
He left
Apoel Nicosia. He went to Cyprus. Yeah,
he left those not so long ago.
Yeah, he. When you look at that as well, you think he didn't really last very long there. They've gone through something ridiculous, like 16 managers in a very short space of time. You think things are bad at Forest and Watford. Mick McCarthy, 7-4 favourite. Mark Bowen, second favourite, 7-2. Craig Bellamy and Paul Cook are 6-1. Tony Pulis, good luck, 8-1. 10-1, Mark Hudson and Michael Flynn, who's the Newport manager. 11-1, Mark Hughes. 12-1, Barr, just to give you a rough idea of where the money is going at the moment.
The EFL confirmed its last round of COVID tests, 32 positive tests out of 4,598 players and staff tested. That was last week. That's down from the previous week of 123 positive tests from 4,038 players and staff tested. Do we think that obviously we're now 3-4 weeks away from Christmas, that could have had a big impact? I'm not going to say anything there. Also, when you look at the fixture list, probably significant less fixtures, more stringent lockdown, obviously playing a part, but when you look at that, that's like, you know, a significant reduction, which is what we want to see across the board.
Yeah, and that's a bit more bit more positivity. I know it's still a horrible situation we're in the middle of a pandemic that seemingly has no end at the minute, but yeah, when you see the figures falling in that sense when it comes to football, but you've got to look at the picture in wider society, and the numbers are still a lot more than, well, they should be. I mean, one is one too many, really, but the numbers are still quite high. There are rules and regulations coming in now where players shouldn't really be making contact with making celebrations and hugging and stuff like that, which I don't know, probably. I don't want to go into the whole debate of footballers being role models and stuff, but maybe they should look at not spitting and swearing live on TV as well. That may be, go a long way towards that as well. But yeah, obviously they're well controlled in their well controlled environments, and it's good that the numbers are coming down, but obviously still, as a country, we've still got a long way to go.
And the rules around celebration were merely lip service to where we are as a society. When you look at some of the corners or free kicks where the players are basically, you know, opposing players, they're standing within a metre, and there's about 20 players all covered around a goalkeeper for a corner, for instance. Jumping up and down and celebrating is going to make such a small difference. However, you've got to be seen to be moving with the times. We've said, as you know, in anyone that's going to work right now, whether it be nurses, footballers, anyone that's going to work is putting themselves at an element of risk. as you say, it's outside of the game where they can minimise that risk, stay in player bubbles, train separately to youth academies, etc. That's where they can minimise this. When you look at that testing, though, that is, for that to be week from week to week, that's more than just an anomaly. That's more than just a statistical anomaly. That's probably players being more stricter with their regimes, and that's showing some really good positive, you know, it's a very small, minute sample size of society, but that shows things going in the right direction. So absolutely positive news. Bang on. So now's where we move on to the team that are going to dominate the news. Derby are currently under a transfer embargo because they haven't paid their players December's wages. Worrying.
You caught me having a mouthful of drink there. Sorry, it's been a long day talking at work. Yes, it is concerning, isn't it? I mean, when you look at the reports that have been on various news media outlets like The Athletic and Sky Sports as well, you're hoping that the takeover is going to go through. It's very protracted at the minute, isn't it? I know we're going to talk about it in a bit more detail. But that needs to happen very quickly for Derby, because there are other situations that are now coming to light as well, where they're talking about player sales, and they've got good young players there who they'd probably want the blood more than having to sell on to plug the holes in the short term. There's another case that we're going to talk about later on in the news as well that could end up costing the club a bit of money as well. It is concerning times, and considering all that is going on in the background, the results on the pitch have actually, in proportion to that, been good, haven't they? Because you've seen so often when things are going wrong behind the scenes, or not going so well behind the scenes, that clubs can capitulate on the pitch, but it's not happened with Derby County. And there is positive news in the managerial situation, Paul, which I think you're going to discuss.
There is. So Wayne Rooney has decided to retire from playing, and he's become the temporary permanent Derby boss, also stating that if the takeover doesn't happen, he would still stay on as Derby County's manager. Originally, when we were saying that it was Wayne Rooney's Derby, we were laughing. That I almost made comments, I think, just after the season started, when Derby's run continued, that how long till Wayne Rooney becomes the manager? It's probably easier to pay him to pay one person to do two jobs than it is to pay two people to do. Do you know? I was almost sort of laughing that, and it was obvious that was something that could happen, but being genuinely surprised with how regal Wayne Rooney comes across, in terms of he looks like a manager, he talks like a manager, he's got that air and that presence, that authority, that he's gone from being, one of the lads, to he's the boss and they do what he just says, and you can see that on the touchline. And that's surprised me.
He's matured a lot, hasn't he? I mean, it's very harsh to judge him on when he broke in. I think he scored him one of his goal that put him on the scene was against Arsenal, I believe, wasn't it, Paul?
Yeah, fluky.
Yeah, that's like, that wasn't fluky at all. 18 years ago, weren't it? If my maths is right. And I always love what David Seaman said when people criticise him for that goal. He said, "What on earth are you doing? I was helping launch his career." I always love that line. But no, his life has very much been in the limelight for many reasons. We're not going to go into that, or we're not here to judge either. But he's matured a lot, hasn't he? And he's always said that he wants to work in management as well. Credit for him. And again, this is not meant to belittle Derby in any way, shape or form. I'd say the same if that was Forest as well. Obviously, there's a rivalry, and I have no pleasure in talking about Derby in these ways. But, in sort of seeing them finding life as hard as they are. He has gone down to the Championship and not thought that his reputation has got him a job at the highest level straight away. And that's credit as well to Frank Lampard, who's done the same thing with Derby and then moved on to Chelsea, although that's not happening at the minute for him at Chelsea, obviously. But he come down to this level to prove himself first before moving up to that next sort of stepping board. He's doing it right. He's saying all the right things. I mean, the quote I got from him here was, "The opportunity to follow Brian Clough, Jim Smith, Frank Lampard and Philip Cocu is an honour. I knew instinctively Derby County was the place for me." He's already appealed to fans of all generations by linking to Clough, who was magnificent for Derby in the 70s, Jim Smith, 80s, 90s. I think he was born 90s and 80s, sorry. But you know, to endear himself and come across as professionally and mature as he has is absolutely brilliant. And with all the uncertainty going on, a little bit of stability in that position with his backroom staff, I think he's been working with them already, hasn't he? You've got Shea Given, Liam Resigna, and Steve McLaren went in as well, didn't he?
Yeah, it's more of a technical director, but not above him.
And he's there on the touchline helping him as well, which is good. I mean, he's been there as a coach and twice as a manager, hasn't he? So he knows the club inside out.
He's someone that, Steve McLaren, let's be honest, he's someone who's so unoffensive. He's someone that, yeah, when you actually hear people talk about him, he's not an egotistical person. He's not out to further his own career. He genuinely, I get the impression, he's there to support Wayne Rooney. And obviously they'd have had, he was his captain when he was the England manager, so they've obviously got a good relationship there.
Yeah, and it's not just that as well. I think Steve McLaren, although he gets pilloried a lot by us as well, and I can say that as a Forest fan as well, because he wasn't very good with us for the like 5 minutes he was with us, but he's obviously a well-regarded coach, whether he's ever took that into the managerial field, apart from Middlesbrough. That's for other people, and FC20, of course, that's for people to judge. But that can only be a benefit to have people like that beside him at this time, because he's still finding his feet. Justin Walker's also part of the first team coaching setup as well. Don't want to forget him. But no, it is good. And the results have improved, and the performances have improved under Wayne Rooney as well. Still a long way to go.
We'll get onto one of those games in a minute, but yeah, they have improved an awful lot.
Yeah.
And he's not going to be able to bring players in. So when you compare him to Frank Lampard, Wayne Rooney's got, I would say, a significantly more difficult job, with the fact that Frank Lampard was able to bring in younger players. When you think of the players that he had, Mason Mount, Wayne Rooney's not going to have that. He's got to work with the squad he's got, because he's probably not going to get this transfer window. If he keeps them up and has any kind of respectable results, it will be because he's worked with the players that underperformed under Philip Cocu.
Yeah, and you're going back to Frank Lampard as well. They had Tomori on loan when he was there as well. He's been subject of linked to or overgone through a massive transfer, isn't he, from Chelsea as well. Talk of multi-million transfer. They had a different calibre of player at their disposal back then.
Harry Wilson?
As well, yes, amongst others. They had a really good squad of players there. And obviously, Wayne Rooney doesn't have that at the minute. Hopefully the pay situation gets sorted out. Hopefully the takeover gets sorted out. As we were talking about the reports in various news outlets, including The Athletic and Sky Sports, there's debate whether the deal is legally binding or not. Apparently it is legally binding, the deal between Derby County and the Ventio Holdings Group. Apparently that's legally binding. There's an issue with previous payments owed for the failed attempt in taking over another club a year or two ago as well. The chief executive's come out of Derby, Stephen Pearce, and said there were no problems with the takeover, and then waxing lyrical about what Wayne Rooney's done as well. There's a lot of stuff that needs to be sorted out behind the scenes for Derby, and I, for one, as well as the footballing community in general, don't like seeing these clubs in turmoil. It's a hard enough time as it is, but with all that black cloud hanging over them at the minute,
adding to that, actually, good segue. Derby are to appeal Richard Keogh's £2 million tribunal award. So, for those of you that don't know, Richard Keogh was involved in a car crash after a Christmas party, when we were allowed to have those type of things, with Tom Lawrence and Bennett. And there was basically a party, car was crashed, Richard Keogh was severely injured, out for a year. Potentially it was a career-threatening injury. He had 2 years left on his contract. Derby gave to Tom Lawrence and Bennett, they gave, they fined them a load of weeks' wages, community service, etc. But they cancelled the contract to Richard Keogh. He's actually been, you know, he took them to a tribunal and he's won. Derby to appeal that, because £2 million is a significant amount of money, especially for a player that's now playing for one of your championship rivals.
Now, yes, was with MK Dons, wasn't he? And then gone to Huddersfield Town. And MK Dons got a transfer fee for him as well, so they've done well to get a free
bin. Straight into Huddersfield's team. We'll talk about that. The other notable transfer that I just want to talk about really quickly is the transfer of Jack Wilshere. Mm-hmm. He's free agent. Been with Bournemouth before. I think a good signing, short term.
Yes, we saw something very similar when Blackburn got Jack Rodwell as well. That turned many heads, because I think that was more to do with what happened at previous clubs than anything else. But Jack Wilshere going to Bournemouth is a potential game changer for them. He is a international caliber player, isn't he? He is definitely with great Premier League great Premier League pedigree. There we go. It's a little bit of alliteration there for you on the podcast. If they can keep him fit and playing, I think he'll be a massive asset to any club in the Championship. But Bournemouth, that could be the difference between them finishing third or finishing second in the long run.
So, the reason we mention that is because I'm going to signpost you to our History of Bournemouth podcast that will be... YouTube video that will be landing this weekend. We look at the... how Bournemouth started, how their last 20 years has gone, and where they are now. So check that out, and also check out the other three videos in that series. Thank you all for listening. As always, I refer to the beginning of the podcast. Do not suffer in silence, because there are always people out there to listen.
Definitely.
Hope you've enjoyed this watching this podcast, because it's really good to get back to Championship football. We do have some FA Cup games, but we've got some Championship games coming up. There might be some slight disruption to our recording schedule for various things we've got going on. But rest assured, we'll make sure that we cover all the news and transfers in detail, whether it be on our YouTube channel or on our main podcast, where we go into a far more detail than we probably should. But we like to talk, so that happens. And lots of thousands of people like watching it, listening to it, so can't be too bad. As always, leave us a thumbs up if you like it. Leave us a comment down below if there's something you think we should cover. Hit the subscribe button to keep getting more videos from us. So that's goodbye from me.
And that's goodbye from me.
And we'll chat to you all at some point in the near future. Bye.
Bye.